What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel.
When you create new variables or instantiate objects, when you call a new method, declare a string, or perform any similar operation, the Java virtual machine allocates memory for these operations. The memory reserved is either inside the stack or the heap part of the memory. In this video, we are going to explain how the JVM divides the memory into a stack and a heap space, allowing our applications to run in an optional and manageable way. So, to make things a little bit more relatable to you, and as usual, let's take this piece of code as an example and try to follow it step by step, line by line, while trying to assign every operation and every variable we create to its corresponding part of the memory. Now, upon launching our main method, the first thing that is going to happen, even before our variables are being instantiated, is that this call, our call to the main method, will be pushed onto a stack different from the stack memory. This one goes by the call stack. The call stack, often shortened to the stack, stores information about the active subroutines of a computer program. What this means is that every call to a new class or every method invocation will be pushed onto this stack. And consequently, a new block of memory will be allocated in the stack memory for each one of these invocations. This new block will store the values of the variables used inside the method and the references to the objects stored in the heap used by the method. To relate this to our code, ID here is a primitive type, hence its value will be directly stored in the stack memory, whereas both the string name and the object channel will have references in the stack memory. These references will point to their actual values found in the heap space. Let's start with strings. Concerning these, there is something inside the heap space we call the string pool, and this pool will store the strings referenced in our stack memory along with all the strings of our application. You see, string allocation, like all object allocation, proves to be a costly affair in both the cases of space and time. So to decrease the number of string objects created in the JVM, the string class keeps a pool of the strings you create in the heap space. And that is where the string we just created will sit. The last variable we are creating here is the channel object. This one will reference or point to the actual object stored inside the heap. At this line of code, it is still null, so there exists nothing in the heap to actually point to, hence we will have a reference in the stack memory. However, this reference will point to nothing at the moment. Okay, we reached the fourth line. Here we are calling the build channel method. So this method will be pushed onto the call stack. Now, because we are passing the ID and the name to this method, the value of the ID and the reference to the name string in the string pool will be created in the stack memory. Additionally, as we are creating a new object of the channel class inside this method, we will have a reference to the object to be created stored inside the stack. This reference will point to whatever is the result of the instantiation. In this code, the use of the new operator will push onto the call stack a new entry, that of the class itself, and with it, a new block of memory will be created in the stack memory. Inside this block of memory, we will have all the class attributes, which are the ID and the name, in addition to the this reference pointing to the actual channel object created inside the heap space. When this object is instantiated, all the references linked to this object will also be updated to reference the same object in the heap space when we go backwards in the code. What I mean by this is that when we are done with a constructor call, the allocated block for it in the stack memory and call stack will be popped, hence returning us back to the build channel method, which now references the correct channel object inside the heap. The same applies on this method, which will be popped, allowing us to return to the main method we started off with, and allowing us to replace the null reference with the actual channel object reference. When the main method is executed, and only after we exit from it, the variables it references in the heap space will be cleaned. You see, that is actually the main difference between the stack memory and the heap space. The heap is used by the entire application during runtime, whereas the stack is used in parts, one at a time, during the execution of a thread. The stack memory stores only primitive variables and references to objects that are created in heap space. Additionally, this memory is automatically allocated and deallocated when a method is called and returned, respectively, in a last-in, first-out manner. However, space in the heap is allocated when new objects are created and deallocated by the garbage collector when objects are no longer referenced. Now, because the stack has a smaller lifetime compared to the heap, and because it stores only primitive values and references in a LIFO manner, the stack memory provides a high-speed access to everything stored inside it, and its space is managed efficiently by the operating system, so memory will never become fragmented. However, heap stack is not used as efficiently, as there's no enforced pattern to the allocation and deallocation of blocks from the heap. You can allocate a block at any time and free it at any time. This makes it much more complex to keep track of which parts of the heap are allocated or freed, hence making the time to access the variables stored inside the heap much slower than the stack. On the other hand, the main advantage of heaps is space. There is no size limit on the heap, whereas the size of the stack is limited by the operating system and fixed, allowing no further nor future changes on it. Let me know in the comments below if you would like a part 2 video for this one that covers everything about garbage collectors and advanced topics on Java's JVM. So that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.